graduate, Kayla and I, we have careers, so there's a few differences. A job is something short-term. You're just there to get that paycheck. Something that has a little opportunity for growth. Usually you just need a high school diploma and you fill out an application, maybe online or some old-fashioned paper application. Versus a career, this is something long-term, and you're there to grow in your experience and your skill set. You're looking to move up the ladder, you know, get those promotions. Typically need a college degree, and then usually you submit a resume with your application. We'll talk about resumes here in just a little bit. But I think really the biggest difference between the job and the career is the career is something that you're passionate about. Something that probably maybe you're majoring in social work because you're passionate about helping people, so then you're going to go be a social worker and case manager. So I'm going to talk about a few of those strategies. You've got a major, you're in college now. What are the next steps for that? So where can you find an open position? Websites are a really good start. Places like Monster.com, Indeed.com, our own Hire Alliance, Glassdoor, LinkedIn, or even company websites. So let's say that you're really interested in working for Freeman Health Systems. They're going to update their own website first before they send it out to any of those third parties. So if you're really interested in working at Freeman, then look at that company website. Don't worry about Monster.com because they might not be updating it as frequently. You can also tap into your network. So you've heard it's not what you know, it's who you know. Because up to 80% of open positions are not posted. They come through word of mouth. So if you're friends with people or have these professional connections around you through your professors or through maybe you've done a job shadow or something like that, you can say, you know, I'm looking to hire somebody. I remember that Shakira girl from her job shadow. She was really good. Let's get her in here for an interview. So a lot of times it's word of mouth or people that know other people, not necessarily a posting that's on these. And then a life hack that I like to do is to set up automatic emails through websites. So that way it will send me new jobs periodically. So if I'm a senior getting ready to graduate or I have another semester, I want to see what jobs are out there before I leave here. I'm going to go to Indeed.com and set up an alert that anytime something administrative assistant is posted, it's going to email that to me so that I can look. It just saves me the trouble from going there. You know, I scroll through my email probably 4 or 5 times a day on my phone. So it's a lot easier to just have it sent to me. Any questions on how to find any open positions? Awesome. So now let's say that you've gone through one of those websites, you found a job posting. Let's go through parts of the posting. First is the job description. This may be labeled as job description, it may be labeled as essential functions, maybe day to day. No matter what it's called, it's going to contain largely the same information. So this is describing what the day to day of the job looks like. The functions, the duties, and responsibilities that you would do. This is just to give you an idea, if you got this job, what would a day in the life look like? Would I be sitting down most of the time? Would I be having to talk on the phone a lot? Just there to set your expectations. These are things that they're going to train you on. You don't necessarily have to know how to do these things before you get the job. And even if you do know how to do these things, if you've worked at U.S. Bank before, maybe Community Bank and Trust wants to teach you their way. Not necessarily the way you know. So the job description is just there to, like the name implies, describe the job. The next part that you will see are the qualifications. This may be also titled requirements, prerequisites. Again, no matter what it's called, it's containing pretty much the same information. So these are the minimum skills necessary to perform the job. The perfect candidate will have all of these skills. Guess what doesn't exist in this world? The perfect candidate. So the person who does this job that they're replacing doesn't have every single one of these qualifications. The person who they will hire does not have every single one of these qualifications. This is perfect world, and I keep working that. This is perfect world, and that doesn't exist. So no one will meet every single qualification. But if you're reading through this and you meet about 50 to 60% of those qualifications, go ahead and apply for that. If it sounds like something you would enjoy doing, and you meet a few of these, I encourage you to go ahead and do it because, again, they're not going to find the perfect candidate. And when it comes down to it, they're really going to hire you based on your personality and your ability to fit within the existing team dynamic and team structure over any of the skills. If they really, really like you and you connect with somebody in an interview, they're probably going to hire you even if they have to train you a little bit more because they like you. They want to invest in you. last part of the posting are the application materials. So this could be the company's application. Maybe it's a website that you fill information in on. You're also going to need a resume, which again we'll cover in just a little bit, and then the cover letter. Different companies may have a little bit different requirements. You might need to sign a waiver for a background check, for instance, if you're going into social work, things like that. But anything that the company is needing or requesting is going to be outlined on there, so you'll know what you need to do. Any questions on the parts of the posting? Pretty straightforward. I feel like pretty much everybody in here has seen some sort of posting you can think through. Some postings are definitely more detailed than others, which is helpful, so you get a better idea. And some just say, seeking intern for like a lab. It's like, okay, well, what am I going to be doing? What are the application instructions? What are the requirements? Sometimes you don't have any of that, which can be frustrating. Okay, so we've talked about resumes a couple of different times. Does anybody have a resume already? Okay, nice. Happy to hear that. We'll go over a few of the best practices while we're in here. The resume is a one-page document that sums up your knowledge, your skills, and your abilities. I want to hammer that in again. Knowledge, skills, and abilities. Basically, this is saying that you have the necessary qualifications. Okay? We have a really great program called Optimal Resume that is free and it is cloud-based. So anytime you log into a computer, you're going to have access to this. If it's saved on your desktop of your laptop and you're 300 miles away from home and you need that resume, you're not going to be able to get it. This is cloud-based, so internet access, you're going to be able to get it. And it does all of the formatting for you. Formatting a resume can be really tricky. There's a lot of templates these days in Google Docs, Microsoft Word, that don't follow resume best practices. So this is going to take all that guesswork out for you. All of the sections of the resume are laid out, the sections that are needed. Again, those outdated templates in Microsoft Word and Google Docs aren't going to do this for you. And then there are dozens of templates to choose from. So you don't want to be like Pam Beasley, or Pam Halper, because she's married to Jim in this season. She can put her resume on a post-it note. Optimal resume is going to make this look a lot fancier and a lot nicer for you if you use that program. So let's go over some resume best practices. Number one rule is that you're going to want to keep it to one page. Unless you've been outside in the professional workforce, so after you graduate college, once you are in the professional workforce for 5 to 7 years, then you can justify having a second page. As a recent college graduate or almost college graduate, one page definitely. You want clean and consistent formatting. Where it gets kind of tricky in formatting sometimes. If you want to move something from the left side of the page to the right side of the page, maybe you get a new page at the end somehow, it's magic, I don't know. But you want that clean and consistent formatting. This is going to show an employer and a recruiter who looks at that document that you do careful work, that you have good attention to detail. Coupled in with that, you want to have zero errors. I have several friends in my network, acquaintances who are HR managers in this area for companies such as Lincoln Platt, TMCO, Liberty Utilities, some of the really big hiring companies around here. And they've told me point blank, if I see a resume that has an error on it, I might overlook one. If I see a resume that has two or more errors on it, I throw it out. Next, thank you. Moving on. So it's really important to run spell check and to have other people take a look at it as well. And then you want to make sure you talk about skills, not tasks. Because those skills are going to be transferable. The tasks are not. I was a cashier at Sam's Club whenever I went to college. In my job right now, I don't run a cash register. I've actually never touched any dollar bills in there. Like, I've never touched any money. So if I had on my resume all my cash register operation, it's not really showing my skills. It's just showing a task or something that was on my list of things to do. But if I talk about those skills that are necessary, so to run my register, I had to have good attention to detail. I had to be really organized. I had to multitask. I had to interact with customers. I had to do all of those things in my job right now. Right now I'm interacting with my customers. I usually have to call students. I have to use attention to detail when I write emails or review resumes. So the skills are things that I put in my little basket and I carry from Sam's Club to my job now. So those skills are really transferable, not necessarily the tasks. And if you think of a cashier at Taco Bell, what they do versus a cashier at Target, even those tasks are different, even though they have the same job title. So the skills are really where it's at. And then you want to tailor to each position. You do not want to send out the same resume to every single job, because every job, looking through that job description, may be looking for different things. So you want to make sure you focus on what the position is looking for, not necessarily just what you have on your resume from the last job. Any questions on those resume best practices? See a couple of things maybe you need to update on your own resumes? Okay, so the cover letter is like the BFF of the resume. The resume is very professional, formal. I like to think of him as like a Secret Service guy. You know, black suit, men in black kind of stuff. Anybody go to a small town high school here? Out in the audience? So at a small town high school, a lot of times the football coach would also be like your history coach or something. And he would wear like khaki shorts and a polo every day. Still looking nice, but not necessarily as professional as other professors or teachers. So the cover letter is a little bit like that coach. He's still professional, but he's a little bit more laid back. The cover letter is a one-page business formatted letter that's providing additional reasons why you're the best person for the job. The fact that it's a letter is more of a storytelling idea. So this is where you're going to let some of your personality show. There's three parts to the cover letter. First, the introduction. It explains why you're interested in the position. It's just a little bit of background detail. Next is the body. And it explains why you're the best choice or you're most qualified for that position. So you're selling them on the idea of you. Hey, I'm so great, you've got to get me in there for an interview. And then the conclusion. This is going to sum up your interest, thank the reader, and include contact information. So anybody in here written a paper for class? You've done these types of things too, where you have the introduction, where you're introducing the idea, and then you justify your thesis, and then you conclude it. Just like that. Just like a report, only it's about you, not about a historical figure or something like that. So a few best practices for the cover letter. Again, you want to make sure that you have flawless formatting. So business letters have very specific formatting and spacing. Optimal Resume does all of this for you. I have yet to find a good template in Word that does it. You just kind of have to wing it, which is not that fun. Again, you want zero errors, so run a couple of spell checks, have somebody else look at it. You want to reinforce ideas on your resume. Kind of restate the same ideas. And then you definitely want to show your personality, because way back in the olden days, in the 1980s, when you applied for a job, you'd go in person and talk to the owner or the manager. They could see if you were weird or not. Now we're strangers behind a computer screen, so we're applying for a lot of jobs anonymously, and they don't know us. So the cover letter is a really great way that we can introduce ourselves and show a little bit of personality. Notice I put an exclamation point on there. That's my personality. I am an exclamation point, probably overuser, but that's something that I would put in my letter to show my enthusiasm or how excited I was for this position. And then again, you want to tailor to each position. So the letter is addressed to somebody specific. If you're applying for a job in my office, you would address it to me. Talk about why you were so excited to work in career services, but if you wanted to apply for a job in the library, I don't work for the library. You wouldn't address it to me, you would address it to Kayla. So it just needs to be tweaked and updated a little bit depending on the position. 5-10 minutes is usually all it takes. Yes, our first question!
What do you mean? How do you talk about yourself without sounding too cool yourself?
You do want to sound a little bit full of yourself, so I will say that. It feels like I'm somebody who makes fun of myself a lot, so it feels really unnatural for me to say how awesome I am or something. I use the job description as my guidepost, and I look at those requirements, because looking at those requirements is telling me why I wanted to apply in the first place, right? Like, oh, I can do that. Oh, I can do that too. So I use that as my guidepost or my prompt, and then I write sentences based on sort of those lines. So if one of the things they were looking for was a highly organized individual, I would say, I'm a highly organized individual. In fact, I color code my two calendars. I have different Sharpies for different days and things like that. So I just use that as sort of line by line things that I can write about. And then I don't have to think of the ideas myself either. I'm using their ideas. Does that help? Yes, ma'am.
Can build off that. As someone who has to help hire people a lot, sometimes these things can sound arrogant, but there's a difference between like the job, like applying for a job and sounding a little arrogant and sounding like almost snooty, I would say, because I've seen both. And you're putting forward, it's like coming out in a ball gown instead of coming out in a sundress, essentially, when you apply for a job. You're going to be a little showy. You're going to be a little bit more, maybe, than you are in your everyday life. But that's okay, as long as you don't come out in like a Lady Gaga ball gown, like, because then it's too much, and you're overwhelming, and you're like, oh, no, I can't handle this person.
That's a good visual.
So,
yes.
It's okay to be a little flashy and a little showy when you apply, I think. Just not too much. Don't go Gaga. Just go a little far.
So, and I have a handout I'll give you at the end, too, speaking individual. You're looking at maybe 15 to 17 sentences total for the entire document. The spacing makes it look like it takes up a lot more room. The spacing will make it look like a full page, but you're writing 15 to 17 sentences. I guarantee you've written a text message longer than that. You've written papers that are 15 times that long. 15 to 17 sentences is nothing, especially when you look at that job description and they tell you what they want to hear. Just try about that. And add in a thank you for your time and consideration kind of thing in there. And that means you want to know. You got it. Any more questions on that? Hey, I'm Shakira, I applied for this. Like, oh, thank you, I'm Shakira, I applied for this. Just to keep our name in the mind. It would be nice at this time. So, it works out. I wanted to talk just a little bit about professional dress, because unfortunately we are judged on how we look and how we're dressed, whether or not we believe in it. Those first impressions matter. About 58% of a first impression is based off of how we look. So, 75% of recruiters believe how you dress affects your job performance. So if you're going to a job interview in pajamas, they think, oh, that person's lazy, couldn't even get dressed today, they're not going to do the job very well. So a couple things here for ladies, if we're going to wear dresses or skirts, we want to make sure that they hit about knee length. I know, like, high school dress code was fingertip length, but even if it's fingertip length and you sit down, it's still going to ride up a little bit. So knee length is the convention. You also don't want it too tight. This isn't club wear. We're not trying to impress them by how sexy we are. We're trying to impress them with our skills. She's not showing any cleavage or her arms, which is a little bit old-fashioned for a professional dress. I do think a short sleeve, nice top would be okay. You could throw a blazer over that or something. Or you could even wear pants if you're more comfortable in that. For the dudes, which there's not any in here, but they're maybe watching at home. Suit, tie, jacket, kind of standard fare there. You do want to stick to what they call neutrals. So black, gray, maybe blue. If you want to add a pop of color in there, that's fine, maybe in your accessories, but you don't want to wear like a bright yellow shirt or something bigger. The interview is not the time to impress them with your outfit. It's the time to impress them with the way you're carrying yourself, saying, how you're presenting your skills, things like that. Here's a couple of bad examples for ladies. She needs to button up her shirt, just a little bit more there at the top. Her skirt is borderline, maybe too tight, but it's also, I can tell where it's hitting when she sits down, especially if it's tighter, it's going to ride up, and she's going to get everybody a peep show. For the guys, he is wearing a blazer, yes, but he's wearing it with a t-shirt, so it's a little bit more casual. And then he's wearing jeans and sneakers, which are not going to be great for the interview. But the quagmire and the caveat to this is that different industries are going to expect different levels of dress. So if you work in banking or finance, traditionally a little bit more old-fashioned, bank casual Fridays are usually khakis and a polo and dress shoes. Whereas Missouri Southern casual Fridays, I wear jeans, Chuck Taylors, and an MSSU t-shirt. So it just depends on kind of where you work. that platform the same way that you do your LionNet. Those credentials are the same, so you don't have to remember any password or anything like that. And then you just filter those jobs by on-campus employment, part-time on-campus, and then it's got all the different jobs on there. If you want to stop by my office Wednesday and Thursday this week from 1 to 3, I have open availability, and I'd be happy to kind of walk you through that and show you how to get in there and find those things.
The library, at least for my desk, which is reference and circulation, generally from 8 to 5 Monday through Friday, just because it's not as busy on the weekends. But, like, for example, I have students who come in at 9, work for an hour, go to class, and then come back at 11. So we can make exceptions for that, but, like, other works probably wouldn't be able to do. Things like that. The library will have a bunch of open positions, too. Probably the summer and the fall, because we have a bunch of people graduating. So I usually have people stick around when they graduate. Generally, I build my schedules every semester based around the schedules my student workers give me. So, like, they say, okay, I have class from, you know, 9 to 11 and then 2 to 4. So I'm like, okay, great. So you can work, you know, 8 to 9 and 12 to 1 and blah, blah, blah. And it changes every semester, kind of. So it just depends on the department, I think, but usually yes, because they know you're a student. And you're kind of both. You're an employee, but you're also still a student. So
you were starting to say questions.
I was gonna say
your first clue that that's funky, right?
Yeah.
And then different people are sending you the same message. So what has happened is that a student, not unlike yourself, saw an email like that and fell victim for that scam, unfortunately. And then their email gets hacked. So now the hacker has access to their email and they're sending out this message to everybody in the MSSU address book. So if you see a message like that, if you see a job that seems like, oh, too good to be true, I can make $500 a week, working from home, and I don't have to do anything. It's like,
yeah, that's like running errands and doing different things, sending out emails and blah, 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 and you want to like my address and personal information.
Unfortunately, somebody's not hacked. Yes, so the only time you should give out personal information like that when you're applying for a job is if you're actually talking to that person in their place of business, or if you're filling out an application online or something like that.
I was wondering because, okay, so
and it'll start with like an MSC card.
Yeah,
it'll end with like Gmail or something.
As long as you don't have any links or anything, you'll be good.
Yeah.
Because I was trying to figure out how like to tell if it's a legit email or not, because I know that I went into career services before and one of the guys in there helped me put my resume, I guess, on her line.
They're never going to contact you.
Oh, okay.
Nobody is
that
ever going to email you directly about the job.
No?
No.
Okay, so will it be like a phone call?
You have to apply for something for them to contact.
Well, he told me that he was going to send out my email, or my resume, to some different companies, and then that they would contact me, or that they...
I don't know what he told you. That's not the thing that we do, though. Why don't you come see me sometime? 1 to 3, Wednesday or Thursday work for you?
Yeah, well, I'll have to look at the MSP.
Okay.
Yeah, I was like, I wasn't understanding how that worked because he said, is it, you know, he asked me, is it okay if I send your resume to a few companies that I know? I was like, yeah, that's fine. And
that seems weird. Okay.
And then, so.
You remember who it was?
Some guy was like, he was in there all the time.
Like,
yeah.
Or like, full on beer.
He was more clean and sure.
Okay, come see me, because this is weird and I don't know.
Yeah, and that's why I was like, I didn't know if these companies were.
I can see why you think that now, yeah.
So, and then I started getting like emails, so I didn't know if they, you know, they were like, how do I tell which one's the legit